Excuse me. Could you tell me where the graveyard is?
We don't have a graveyard here.
I'm a necromancer. I need corpses, dead flesh, skeletons.
No, I'm sorry. That's not what we do here.
Would it be all right if I killed you and then brought you back to life?
We're here at Friday Night Magic, here at the Soldiery in Columbus, Ohio. This is Jacob Brandstetter. He is a local player. How would you describe the difference in gameplay between Friday Night Magic and a big event like a Grand Prix?
Well, to me, it's a little more stressful, like making sure I'm not, you know, screwing up, no takesies, backsies, types of things like that, worrying about making sure you got the life totals right. That always worries me a little bit in a grand scale, but... And I guess in that sense, it's just not as casual, you know, it's not quite, you got to be a little more serious if you want to, like, you know, make day two and, you know, and God willing, you know, money, you know.
How would you describe the difference between playing in the store and playing at a big event like a Grand Prix?
Oh, totally different level. I mean, thousands of people. I mean, there's pros everywhere. I mean, we'll probably get, like, some medium player here that's pretty good. Like, it'll take the FNM down, but no caliber. Like, it's... The GP is just totally on another level.
It seems so warm and cozy and, like you said, casual in the store. Why make the jump to playing in a Grand Prix at all?
Oh, man, I mean, tournaments are where it's at. That's why you play casual, is to get ready. You know, I mean, part of it is, you know, to get ready for the big tournament where you really can see how good you are in a large field of people who play the game that you play every week and you love so much, you know? Like, it's a lifestyle, man. Magic is a lifestyle.
So you said you'd love to make day two. What would be a satisfying finish to you if there's, I don't know, 900 or 1,000 players? What number or what place would you feel satisfied with?
42.
Gerard, I wanted to ask you something about the metagame.
Okay.
Maybe not necessarily Magic's metagame, but how would you define the term metagame?
All right, so pretty much it means whatever everybody else is doing, you kind of want to, you know, stray away from it and do something that will beat them, but then you have to be on the next level because other people are going to be trying to do the same thing. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it kind of works in like a big circle. And it's just super, super crazy.
You know, you have all these disparate groups of people who all have their own kind of unique ways in which they can accomplish this one similar goal. And so the idea of a metagame is you're trying to figure out, okay, get into their head. How did they think the best way to fix this problem was? And then, you know, that leads to you know, concepts of leveling, saying, okay, if they think that's the best way, do I want to do what I think is the best way or what I think is the best way to mess with what they think the best way is? Where it gets complicated is, you know, you want to make sure that you're not sacrificing kind of a linear, proactive, and efficient strategy on your own just because you want to attack these certain decks that are doing really popular. This is Magic unique. You know, there are certain cards that are just universally popular, and if you're not playing with some of them, you know what I mean, you're probably, you know, overthinking it, and that's a danger of the metagame.
Okay, Jacob, how's your Grand Prix going so far?
So far, pretty good. X and one. Had some favorable matchups.
You said yesterday your goal was to make day two.
Yeah.
Seemed like a realistic goal?
I think it's realistic, sure. I just got to stay focused. That's a lot of times my problem. Start to get tired, lose focus, start making mistakes. So keep that focus up.
Alex, you won Pro Tour Avacyn Restored with your team of Canadians as collaborators. Yeah. Was that just a fluke, or is Team Canada an actual threat at the World Magic Cup at Gen Con this year?
Oh, Canada's a rising force in the Magic world. We're starting to dominate. You're going to start seeing a lot more of us, and I think we have a really good chance of taking down the World Magic Cup.
Now, Canada is the butt of a lot of jokes in the United States. I know this. I've been guilty of making Canada jokes myself before. How badly does Canada want to get some revenge on the U.S. if given the chance in the World Magic Cup?
I don't know. Not that badly. I mean, you know, we kind of don't really look at you guys as that much of a threat.
I'm here with four-time Grand Prix top eighter David Ochoa. David, how's it going?
Okay.
Cool. Well, good luck in the tournament.
Yeah, man. Thanks. Yeah.
Cut.
Yeah, I thought that was good.
Jacob, you came very close but fell just short of making the cut for day two. Did you feel as though you were prepared for the metagame that the Grand Prix had for you?
Well, I just got annihilated by zombies, and I didn't even know that was a deck in this format, so I guess not completely.
When you think of the great deck builders of the world, what names come to mind?
Well, first of all, I want to say this is kind of disconcerting. I don't often look up to people during interviews. So I'm having trouble. I feel like my brain is off to one side.
There
right
we
now.
Go. All right, ready?
Okay, yeah, that's good. I'm 6'3", so you know, I don't look up to it. Anyway, Sam Black, is burst onto the scene recently with just a string of incredible successes, whether it's the Lingering Souls deck or the Infect deck or the Blue-Green Spirits deck that we had in Barcelona that, of course, I didn't play because it doesn't have white in it. But, he's really come into his own, and he's extremely cerebral, really good at building mana bases.
How do you go about analyzing the metagame in such a way that you can build a deck that nobody's prepared to play against? Do you, like, scour the databases to try to find cards that people don't think of? What is your research method like?
Well, it doesn't involve a lot of scouring databases because I'm very, very, very into, like, following cards as they come out, and I draft a lot, and I basically just know all the cards. Mm-hmm. And so, like, my ability to just, like, someone will be like, well, I want a card that does this. I don't usually need to do, like, a search for a card that does that. I can just tell them what cards their options are.
It is a commonly held dream among Magic players to not only win a tournament, but to do so with the mark of your own creativity. Is there any greater joy than to, you know, make top eight with your own creation?
It was certainly one of my dreams, and it's very great. It might be not as good as beating someone who is happy to be losing to you because they're so excited to see what you're doing.
The point of my deck is to play a bunch of Rock'em Sock'em robots and turn them sideways.
Attack with small aggressive creatures and finish them off with burn spells.
Turn 3 Karnia, bro.
The point of my deck is to play Geist St. Draft and bash them in.
I'm trying to control the board and cascade into the winning spells. I make a million Restoration Angels to kill my opponent.
Snapcast something?
One word. The Dalkin Shackles.
In the finals, Canadian World Magic Cup competitor Lucas Siao squared off against the soulless, brutal robots commanded by newcomer Jacob Maynard. Maynard struck first by blowing up his own machines to shower Siao with a rain of deadly shrapnel, and finished him off with the mythical power of this metal helmet. But Xiao struck back with a barrage of lightning bolts to win game two, and though he melted Maynard's lesser robots with volcanic fallout in game three, Maynard's etched champion endured, vanquished the Canadian, and carried his master to first place out of 1,042. Of all the decks that you could have played in this metagame, why'd you choose to play Rock'em Sock'em Robots?
Because Rock'em Sock'em Robots are awesome.
Congratulations, Jacob Maynard. This is the first time you've ever made the Sunday cut at a Grand Prix, and you took down the whole thing.
Feels good.
So, Paul, I wanted to ask you, what is the concept of the metagame?
Well, I guess the real question is, what is what is a metagame?
Go ahead, you just do it over.
Right as I was about to say, it's really serious. I had a very good thought.
Well, we're feeding the trolls by shooting even near Owen.
Troll, okay. Owen turned low. Well.